Yes, you're watching GH Today on GH1 TV with Kafui and Beiswa. Remember, coming up, we're going to take boxing lessons from King Kong right here on the set. Of course, there's NX with AJ and Sports Chat with Dennis Mupuri. But before we jump into hard talk, Beiswa has some really good news for you.
Okay, so well, we know that this is the month of love, and for us at GH1 TV, we are mending broken hearts in the home with the family. Do you have any issue with your parents as a child? Parents, do you have issues with the kids? Do you, are you willing, you know, to come out and get it sorted? Okay, that's what we're doing for us, our viewers, this time of the year, the Valentine period. And we're asking that you email us your story of that broken heart to our email address, and that is promotions@gh1tv.com. Email the story in that relationship with your parents, with your child, and we will be here to pick the best and discuss it. Now, use hashtag, don't forget though, use hashtag Mending Broken Hearts, and let us hear from you once again on GH1 TV. We definitely are on all the social media platforms, Facebook as well, Twitter, Instagram. And so keep those stories coming through to these platforms if you're not able to get through to promotions@gh1tv.com. Can broken hearts really be mended? I think they can.
Yes, I agree. I agree.
Yeah, and so yes, we're not just giving chocolates to lovers, but we're concerned this time around more about the home and indeed the family, the relationship between parents and the children. Okay, so let's see how that plays out. Okay, okay. What did Kobe say?
We are ready for hard talk now. Our guests are seated, and let's get into a conversation on security and facing those threats which are emerging. GH Today, follow us on Twitter at GH1 TV and send in all your comments and across social media as well. Now, we are how many days away from the election? So 280, 279, 278, 276. 276 days away from November 7th. That's the day of the election. And you know, when we are in running up to the elections, there are so many issues that come up, and there are calls for peace. And then there's a sense that our security is threatened. Now, what does that mean for you and me? And are we facing the threats to the security of this country? Yesterday at the Alisa Hotel, there was a thought leadership event hosted by Star 103.5 FM, our sister station, under the auspices of the EIB network, our parent group. And it brought together very, very distinguished speakers to talk about the issue of security. We had the Honorable Deputy Minister for the Interior, James Agalga. We also had Dr. Emmanuel Kwesi Enning from the Kofi Annan International Peacekeeping Training Center. And we also had Major General Retired Coleman. And they spoke on various issues. Let's, before we even introduce our guest to you, listen to our first video, or watch the first video from that event yesterday. It's Major General Retired Nikal Coleman. He spoke about security structures in Ghana. He spoke about the National Security Council and other issues and what we need to focus on. So take a look at this video, and then we'll come back and have the conversation inside the studio. This is GH1 TV. Stay with us.
As a nation, we have inherited a defense and security structure, and I dare say a security structure that is woefully unsuitable for the world we live in today. We must make determined efforts to learn from those mistakes and make the changes needed. In an age of uncertainty, we need to be able to act quickly and effectively to address new and evolving threats to our country. That means having access to the best possible advice and, crucially, the right people around the table when decisions are made. It means considering national security issues in a very holistic manner, recognizing that when it comes to national security, foreign and domestic policies are not separate issues, but two halves of the same coin. The first step I offer is that to make sure that the government takes decisions properly, Therefore, we must have a National Security Council that is both functional and efficient. The National Security Council brings key ministers and military and intelligence chiefs. Ideally, they must be meeting weekly. Ideally, I stress that. They must be meeting weekly and should be driving the culture of change at the presidency or the seat of government, placing a powerful structure right at the heart of government to make sure our limited resources are deployed to the best effect. Second point is that the National Security Council must oversee the development of a proper national security policy and strategy. To be useful, this policy and strategy must allow the government to make choices about the risk we face. Of course, in an age of uncertainty, the unexpected will happen, and we must be prepared to react to that by making our institutions and infrastructure as resilient as we can. The third point that I want to make is that we must place much more emphasis on spotting emerging risks and dealing with them before they become crises. To do that, we need to draw together and use all the instruments of national power so that the total sum of the Ghanaian effort is much bigger than its component parts. We are entering an age of uncertainty. We must therefore develop a strategy that will gear Ghana for this new age of uncertainty, weighing up the threats we face and preparing to deal with them. But a strategy is of little value without the tools to implement it. So along a national security strategy, we should develop our strategic defense and security reviews constantly. This will describe how we will equip our security agencies or armed forces, our police and intelligence agencies to tackle current and future threats effectively. To help up with our discourse, therefore, I wish to throw out these few questions for a deep and serious reflection. As a people, to what extent do we conceive or understand and prioritize national security interests from a non-partisan perspective? Two, to what extent do our politicians prioritize and think about national security interests above their political interests? And do such political interests support short-term or long-term interests? Three, do we have an integrated risk management system in place? If so, how many of our citizens are aware of this and its functionality? Four, do we strengthen our oversight mechanism? How do we strengthen our oversight mechanisms? And to what extent do the oversight bodies have access to the requisite resources that need to do their work? In other words, do they have the necessary capacity to discharge their functions effectively and impartially according to their conscience and not to the dictates of parliamentary whips and political short-termism? How do we avoid partisanship in our political discourse on matters of national security?
So that was Major General Retired Coleman speaking on the structures that we have in Ghana that deal with security. We can now welcome our guests and have this conversation with them. We have Reverend Amudako, he's the chairman of the National Platform of Disaster Risk Reduction. Reverend, good morning.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you very much.
Okay. And we also have Honorable Kwame Agboja, who is a member in the Defense and Interior Committee in Parliament and also a Member of Parliament for the Adaklu constituency. You're welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, it's a pleasure to have you here. We want to just jump on to what the Major General was saying with structures. And the first question is, what is orientation? Are we aware of the threats that exist? And do we ride on political sentiments or we think bigger than just what we can win from a particular situation as a particular political party?
Well, thank you very much, and good morning to your cherished viewers.
I think basically security or safety is a mindset. Why do I say this? For instance, when you think of safety, when you go to sleep at night, what do? You try to lock your doors and check that everything is all right. When you get out of your car, you lock the doors and check that it's actually locked before you leave it. The second thing is that there's nothing like total security anywhere in the world. Even the most advanced countries are, in fact, they face bigger threats than us. Fortunately for us in this country, I don't think we have identified any state actors that are looking to harm us. It's probably the issue about people feeling that they don't get what they want, or they think they can use what we call the freedom in this country to do whatever they like. For instance, if you were to stand at a train station in London and shout, "I've got a gun," you will be arrested and thrown into jail first. And then if it's found out that you did it deliberately, you could even be charged for wasting police time. But in this country, democracy means that you can say whatever you like and get away with it. You can be assured that maybe 70% of the platforms in this country, especially radio in this country this morning, are saying things that require the person be questioned. But then, if you go on that route as well, then you become somebody which other people will call you, are becoming a police state. So it's all about the mindset. Look, there's different levels of security in this country. First of all, when you think there's a threat, you go and work maybe to stop it from happening. Then when you think it's manifested in a way that it's about to be implemented, you try to neutralize it. Unfortunately, if it happens, you have the infrastructure to deal with the aftermath, unfortunately. Fortunately, we don't have that much in terms of, it's just, for instance, somebody will say that, oh, go on radio, well, if the electoral commissioner doesn't do this, do that, when the election comes and there's violence, and you ask yourself, the fact that you win or lose election, does that warrant somebody taking arms against somebody? Well, if that somebody thinks like that, if you can identify the people, don't wait until it gets there. Find out if they are capable of doing that and neutralize them before we get there. So, and I am not aware that I'm a politician. I'm not aware that I've got any plan to harm anybody if I lose an election, because you can win an election, you can lose an election. I always say that I'm a product of competition. Somebody lost for me to win. So if I lose, so be it. The guy who lost is going on with his work. So why is it that when I lose, it becomes another thing? I always urge that people who go into politics, you must find a day job. If you are not capable of getting a day job that pays you, don't go into politics, because once you get there, you think you have to remain there forever. And I urge everybody. I always tell my colleague MPs, if you are a lawyer, you are a teacher, you are an architect, maintain your day job whilst you're in parliament, because that is what you are. Honorable is not a profession, or whatever you call it. It's not a profession. It's just a service. And a service, look, it's just like if you're a service, you can decide not to buy water from Ghana Water Company, isn't it? You can decide to use tankers. So they are providing you a service. The people who made you an MP or the president or minister can decide, we don't want you anymore. But then your life must go on. So continue with your day job. And I see this thing, anytime there's election coming, we all are driven by a mindset that we are heading to a disaster, that there's something going to go wrong. Who actually is going to do this? The people who are going to do this are the people who are talking loosely. So deal with them. If they've spoken out of context, if they've spoken in a way that creates the insecurity, then deal with them. Don't wait. That is the way I see it.
Honourable, you give the London perspective, let me put it that way. And don't forget that down here, and let me put your constituency in the limelight now. If somebody did something in your constituency today, I know that you would be the first person to be called to go and free this person. In this case, we wouldn't definitely have that happening in England, which perspective that you're using here now.
Well, I'll give you an example. I have, without mentioning names, I've had a situation before. Somebody told me, yes, my son did this and that, and he's in jail, and blah, blah, blah. I said, well, if your son actually did that to somebody's daughter, I have a daughter, and if that person has already been found out, my daughter is safe, so I'm sorry. I can't deal with it. But then I had situations as well where people were wrongly. So the situations must be dealt with on their own merits. The fact that somebody is seeking assistance to get out of jail. Of course, we know there's this justice for something that happens in this country that we found out that a lot of people are behind bars wrongly. They didn't commit those crimes. So depending on the situation, but I doubt if I would follow anybody in my constituency to a police station to free you when it is proven that you have committed a crime simply because of vote. Forget it. You're not going to get me do that.
I think the conversation here, the bottom line is how do you even come in the first place? That if somebody had committed a crime, why in the first place would you be called upon? You know, and what are some of the reactions that you get in your constituency when people like that, you know, come to you and then you give them, you know, this opinion that you have just shared with us?
Being a member of parliament, I say is you are a social worker more than a member of parliament in a sense that hardly does anybody ask you about the laws you make relating to anything. People see you, and that is the society you've built. And a member of parliament, indeed, if there's flooding in a community, the first person they call is, what are you doing about it? If the road is spoiled, what are you doing about it? It's as if the MP has got a budget to fix it.
Do you feel threatened by some of these things?
Well, I don't feel threatened. I think there's the need to for a mindset that needed to be changed. That I think that the same way you cannot be a member of parliament when there's flooding in your community, you say that I've been sent to parliament to make laws, so it's none of my business. You still have to get involved in it. We are called upon to do all sorts of things as members of parliament. I remember very well, I met a gentleman, a schoolmate, who works in the financial institution, and of course, he's probably wealthier than me, but he hasn't got any pressure on him in terms of whose school fees to pay. And he says, if they come to you and say pay their school, can't you just tell them it's not my job? And I said, well, if somebody comes to your house, this is my daughter. She's just passed JHS, this and then needed to progress. And they show you the result, and you look at it, and you tell yourself, I'm not going to do anything about it. It doesn't work like that. But that is the society we live in. You try to do the right thing and hope that people understand that it's not everything that a member of parliament can do, because a member of parliament can't do everything.
Reverend Amudaku, so there were quite a number of issues that the general posed in his, what we saw, and he was asking, what do you make of the issues that he brought up, first of all, concerning the structure of our national security and the things that we need to do to face these threats?
Well, thank you again for the opportunity, and good morning to viewers. I think that what Major General Coleman was saying was relevant in that it's like building a house or whatever that one wants to put up. You want to think about the structure. You want to think about the foundation, building a company. You want to think about a structure, what goes into the organogram, what makes it work, who would make things tick, and things like that. So talking about the structure yesterday was something that I was looking at. It's not new. It's happening. Just as the deputy minister said, the president of the nation is always the chairman of the structure, the system that we have, the council that is in place. His vice is always in attendance. And then we have major ministers of state who, because by virtue of the fact that they would have to make an input, defense, interior, finance, and some other stakeholders in there form it. And then the major security heads that we have in the system. And at least I know during the tenure of President Mills and I was that close to him. And
you were on the Council of State back then.
I was a member of the Council of State back then.
Yeah.
That they met every week, every Monday of the week. They had a meeting and discussed on issues bordering that. In fact, the National Security Council, sometimes would extend the invitation to other people, other stakeholders, such as some relevant people in the system whose issues came up during the time, so that they'll be informed and then act accordingly. So besides the number or the quorum that they normally have, they would co-opt as and when it becomes necessary. And I think that what the general was saying is that we need to be sure that it is on the ground and it is effective and it is running. And that's what he was saying. And I don't know why he probably thought it wasn't there, or whether he was privy to some information that makes him think that it's not working as he suggested, because he's saying that ideally it should be weekly. And at least the one that I knew it was weekly. I'm saying that, yes, that is how it ought to be. It was important, and therefore it must be encouraged.
I'm going to pose the question that Beso posed to Honorable to you, because you're an opinion leader as well, and I'm by virtue of the organizations that you work with, you're also on the Peace Council as well, and a religious man. Somebody goes and misbehaves, threatens the security of some other person or some institution, and his supporters run to you for help. How do you deal with the situation, just like we asked the minister?
Yeah, well,
the member for parliament.
Yeah, I think that he said it right, and we need to understand this, even as religious leaders, because it does happen that people do something untoward. They commit a crime, and they want to be shielded because they belong to my church, or because they think that as a member of Council of State, or because I am in this hierarchy, I should be able to... No, that shouldn't happen.
Sort him out. You don't sort them out.
It doesn't happen that way. See, even in the Bible says that the reason for governance, one of the reasons, is to protect the interests of people, yeah, the rights of people, and then to deal with crime.
But what do you do? I'm sure this happened to you. It has happened so many times.
Exactly so. That is what I'm saying, that therefore being informed, at least by the tenets of Scripture, which is my constitution, I don't condone those things. I don't remember ever in my life shielding anybody who has committed a crime and has run to me.
You're going to be an unpopular or so forth.
No, yeah, you don't do that. You see, just like you said, there are times when people are wrongly, you know, accused of something. Then, of course, you have to stand in and try to help, you know, salvage the situation. But when it is obvious that a crime has been committed, and you want me to shield the person, I don't do that.
Reverend, let me take us back to Major General Coleman's, you know, pointers. And what I get from everything that he said is the fact that we should probably be seeing a departure from where we're kind of mingling political issues with national security issues. Do you agree?
I agree completely, because you see, he talked about politics not being doubled with partisanship, which is the issue. You see, and that is something that is a bit unfortunate. We are losing sight of being Ghanaians first, before we belong to any other political party. You know, political parties are parties that can constitute a government to rule a nation. But the nation is primary. It's more important than anybody's political party. So if, such as we are finding ourselves now, in a contest where there is a government out of a political party, we need to put aside all aspects of partisanship and allow the system to operate. You know, for example, all of them cited this issue of the Fulani herdsmen and what is happening now.
Exactly.
You know, we needn't double into these things partisanly. We need to look at it holistically as Ghanaians and then deal with the situation as we find it. Who are these Fulanis? And yesterday, I think we found some answers that not all Fulanis are foreigners. Some of them, per our constitution, are Ghanaians because they were born, during the periods which constitutionally makes them Ghanaians, all right?
Yes.
So we don't then therefore think of all Fulani herdsmen being foreigners who have invaded our land. Let's deal with them. Let's sack them. Let's
flush the word
flush them out.
Flush.
You know, the moment you do that, then you may be seen to be doing something that is not completely right.
All right, Reverend. by the way, Reverend, we met Reverend yesterday for the very first time at the event. It was good to meet you there. And at that event, one of the speakers was Dr. Emmanuel Kwesi Ening. Now, he is the director at the Faculty of Academic Affairs and Research at the Kofi Annan International Peacekeeping Training Center. Mm. And he spoke on how to build a resilient country. Take a look at the video, listen to what he said, and we shall continue the discussion on Securing Ghana 2016 with our guests right here. This is GH1 TV, and you're watching GH Today.
Strong country that survives 2016, I think is key. But to be able to do that, we need to be bold and frank and to ask ourselves what are the most difficult challenges and what are the realistic challenges that we face. I'll make one straight point. There are old security threats in this country that have been with us for about 40, 50, 60 years, which have not been resolved. And superimposed on these old threats are new threats, some of which my elder brother, General Coleman, has spoken about, of terrorism, of organized crime, of small arms, and increasingly of human trafficking. And therefore, whilst not going into the nitty-gritties of some of these old problems, I'll mention them tangentially and sort of, you know, try to generate some conversations. But I think as we move towards preparing for election 2016, I think it behoves on all of us to build strong, resilient, responsive, and responsible communities. Everybody has a responsibility. But the threats that we face have challenged us due to poor security threat perceptions. We just don't get it as to what threatens us in this country. We lie about it. We write bogus reports upon which wrong decisions are made. Agogo ought not to have happened and heads must roll.
And we remember in 2010, when we arrested the three Akada guys in Accra and then first renditioned them to Morocco and onward to New York, they had come here as businessmen until we arrested them. Okay, so we need to be asking tough questions about some of these activities that generate considerable amounts of income. On the terrorism side, I think it's also important for us, for those who are computer savvy, to begin to listen to the discourses and the chatter that is happening around. If you listen and you read, there's a certain perception that two things that I think I want to bring up. I think Boko Haram becoming an Islamic state in West Africa is crucial and critical. I think it's a game changer. Piracy is a big business. Right now, we are not facing too much of a problem ourselves, but this is a West African-wide organized crime once more, costing about $7 to $12 billion annually. But we are also beginning to see that when pirates strike, they look for specific things. They look for the authentication systems, they look for the communication devices, and they look for the electronic chat systems. Okay, allowing them to have a better understanding and feel for what happens in West Africa. But we are also beginning to see a growing stock market. A stock market that is ever widening and that has resulted in interested parties investing in future hijacks by paying or offering money and weapons. Individuals and groups invest in a pirate group, and if they obtain ransom money or money from stolen goods or oil, they get their share. The seizures that Bernard spoke about are just the tip of the iceberg. The small arms seizures are just the tip of the iceberg. The challenges that we face with small arms in this country are much more serious, underpinned by culture, history, a desire to reenact old wars, and also used for rise de passage. Unfortunately, the manufacture, sales, stockpiling, and the trade is increasingly being criminalized.
So that was Dr. Enin speaking on the need to get a really resilient structure as far as our security is concerned. He spoke about threats from the piracy, threats from Boko Haram, and you get the sense that, look, it's not just a national thing we are dealing with here. It's both national and foreign. And the general spoke about the need to have our policies in sync, domestic and foreign. Honorable Agboja, you sit on that Defense and Interior Committee. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think generally Ghana is doing very well in terms of some of the things. And I'm saying that the rest of the things that appears not to be, of course, I can't say that we have gotten all the things we need in terms of logistics and other things, but in the circumstances. And he just, Dr. Eni just spoke about something. We were able to arrest some people who were, allegedly Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda operatives that entered this country. Recently, somebody murdered the girlfriend and the children and was able to go through immigration in another kingdom and leave the country without their knowledge. But we arrested him within a week or two when he entered this country and in the process of sending him back. We can do a certain level, but I'm saying that the level of insecurity that is in this country is self-inflicted. That is people going around shouting there's going to be crime, there's going to be violence after the election and other things. And the thing is, you can only legislate against this thing. And that legislation would surely become a tool for somebody to say that you are building a police state. So, like he rightly said, the security starts from the community. People must understand what is doable and what you can say or what you cannot say.
But why is it so hard for the police to pick up people who are obviously doing the wrong thing or saying the wrong thing? Why is it so hard?
Yeah, because of politics. Believe me, I've said it.
Is the police force politicized?
No. They have come out to say that sometimes when something happens, instead of them taking action, political actors intervene. For instance, if somebody goes and takes an offensive weapon or threatens to harm somebody, the fact that he wears a political party T-shirt doesn't mean that he has the right to do that. But believe me, try to get involved and the one side of the political divide makes it a political issue. But that shouldn't have been the case.
Policemen can arrest Okada riders. Today I'm seeing police impound motorbikes in Accra. There's a picture there, today's Daily Graphic. It's easy for them to arrest motorbike riders, but
because they are the soft target, they don't wear any political party.
Low hanging fruit.
Yes, that is what it is.
But
believe me, if any political party is going to have a rally or other things, just take your camera there and see how many motor riders are breaking the law. How many of them do they arrest on that day?
It's interesting, and I put that question to Rev before we went on to this next topic. Yeah. Listen, why do we tend to put national issues, or should I say political issues, on national issues, especially when it comes to national security?
Well, I think for some reason.
And the situation that we find in Ghana, it's usually the political interests over the national interests.
Well, for some reason, we have become a country that believes that politics can solve all the problems, strangely. How many political parties have built successful businesses? I don't take away the fact that political parties are a force for good. They create the environment for things to thrive. But can we say that before the advent of multi-party politics in this country, people were not building businesses in this country? How many of these things can we attribute to direct politics? And we have come to make politics like a do-or-die thing and hide behind it and all sorts of things. So it's not like it's not in other countries. I say that, look, I have seen people get into trouble, even in developed countries, in Britain, get into immigration problem or go and commit a crime, and they run to their local counselor. It does happen. However, going there alone doesn't mean that he's going to get out of trouble. He's going to make sure the right thing is done. In this country, the mindset of power means that somebody who can break the law on your behalf or on his own behalf, and that is what the problem is. But I believe we are getting out of it gradually. I believe that there's a cater core of people in this country who are prepared to do the right thing and damn the consequence. Recently, I heard the Ashanti Regional Police Commander threatening to arrest one of my colleagues. And I was telling some people that there's no law in Ghana who says that members of parliament cannot be arrested. In fact, if I get out of this place and I pull a gun trying to shoot at somebody, who says that the police cannot arrest me?
But you tell us that you're on your way to parliament.
That law is well defined. That law was brought in simply because, for instance, assuming there's going to be a vote in parliament on an issue that a section of the public is against, so and they know my stand on it, they can decide that, okay, you have committed a traffic offense, we're arresting you.
You don't go and vote.
Mm. That's what they're talking about. But if you pull a gun and put it against somebody's head, that has nothing to do with you going to parliament. And that is a criminal offense.
And your colleague said serious things. He said, look, he's not for people doing the wrong thing. Nobody should go and kill any Fulanis, but you should attack their cows.
Well, you see, I have a whole concept about this Fulani thing. Cattle rearing is farming, isn't it?
It is.
We want to promote
livestock farming. Yeah.
I have got that problem in Adakulu. And I've gone into it and I've realized, look, and I called some of my elders and said,
you have the Fulani's in your area.
Of course,
well,
it's a big issue. Mm-hmm. I mean, our water bodies have been destroyed. I said, look, these people didn't drop from the sky. They came to this community. People gave them land to engage in the activity. The only problem is that the land that has been given to them, they don't even graze there. They are trespassing into other people's land. So the first point of addressing the thing is the landowners must ensure that whoever you put on your land as a guest or you sold the land to maintain his or her activity within the boundaries. If that is solved, that would have been the end of the trouble. But you see, they don't stick their necks out that much because they know that their activities are endangering everybody.
You so consider them a threat in your constituency?
Of course, but not a threat in the sense that I don't want them there or I think they are, after all, my district assembly have gone to build a cattle market in the district. If you actually thought the cattle or their owners are not necessary, why do you create a revenue point? So it means that you think you can derive some benefit from them.
Taxes.
How exactly? So if the issue is about overgrazing, destruction of water bodies, let's limit it to a crime. Destruction of water body, is it a crime? Destroying somebody's farm, is it a crime? And deal with it as a crime instead of making Fulani, like he said. There are some people rearing cattle in Adakulu who have been in Adakulu before I was born. How do I call them strangers? They're not strangers. They belong to the community. However, they might be committing crime. So whether it's me who commits the crime or they who commit the crime, crime is crime, must be punished.
So look for the crime and don't criminalize the whole people.
Exactly. Yeah.
Rev, let me come to you. Let's look at security in general. Per the state of security in our country today, would you say that people feel good about this? And if indeed they do, how do you think that is going to translate at the elections?
Yeah, thank you very much. I think that there's a lot of noise, acrimony. People, just as he had said earlier on, you know, people poisoning the system, trying to create a mindset of danger, violence, and, you know, those kinds of things. From what I said, I don't see it that way. We are going to go into an election. An election is to go choose people who will govern us. So people who want to be in the election and participate as contestants must you know, come forth with their messages. And yesterday I was making a passionate appeal to your folks in the media, print, and also in the electronic, be it television or radio. Please, let's be careful that during our tenure, as people who are within this part of the world, Ghana, during our tenure as people who are now living, not in the times of our fathers, and who know that we would have to hand over the baton to our children and to our children's children. Let us not destroy our country by virtue of what we say or what we write. Informed by what somebody wants to achieve as a politician. Let's be careful. Because see, it all boils down to that. The security of this nation for me is safe until we begin to make comments that are adversary, that is, you know, that can make people want to do things that is untoward. For example, I cited experience of Rwanda. It emerged out of a radio program. Minds must not be poisoned because of somebody's or some people's interest or wanting to become whatever. You see, we shouldn't be inciting people to do things that would result in chaos, that would result in our Ghana being destroyed during our time. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that we only have this time to live. We didn't make Ghana what it is. We are coming from somewhere. We've traveled a long way. You know, our forefathers, our fathers, and this is our time. And I'm saying that if Jesus should tarry, our children, our children's children will have to also continue to live. What kind of Ghana are we going to hand over? Because of election 2016, we want to destroy Ghana? I'm saying that let's be candid about the things we say and what we do. Mm. And especially during this period and through the medium of television, radio, and the print media.
Okay, just before we get to the Honorable Deputy Minister, Honorable, you were talking about some different sites that you had visited. Yeah. You care to share a few with
us? Yeah, what I was saying is, for instance, that Dr. Enin talked about the proliferation of small arms. I've visited few defense installations in the world under a certain program. I noticed that most of them are controlled by the state. For instance, when the handguns we buy for our military or the police and other things are controlled by the state. We have a situation in this country where for maybe a century or so, there are known communities in this country that manufacture arms. In fact, all the things I've seen my grandfather use for hunting were manufactured by somewhere. Why don't we have a policy? The defense establishment takes it over, train the people so that they produce these things and licensed. Because, for instance, when I went visited one factory, I was amazed how they put guns together.
In which country was this?
I mean, the Germany and the Czech Republic. It's quite interesting that where they manufacture bullets, where they manufacture certain components of the gun, don't mix up with certain things just to ensure control of this. You can't stop people from manufacturing small arms, yet you know that the situation is there. You do nothing about it. Then you keep complaining about it. Mm-hmm. Defense, a suggestion. Go to Alavanu and other places, take it over, train them. Whatever they manufacture comes through a log, and you know who has got access to it. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we are pretending, where does the small arms come from? Okay. They come from our community.
We know where they're coming from, exactly. So we need to just systematize it so that we know exactly where it is.
Control.
Okay. Well, in case you joined us, this is GH Today Hard Talk. And the gentleman who just spoke is Honorable Agboja. He is on the Defense and Interior Committee in Parliament. He's also the Member of Parliament for Adaklu constituency. And next to him is Reverend Dr. Niamudaku. He's the chairman of the National Platform of Disaster Risk Reduction. We are basing this conversation on the thought leadership event that took place yesterday at ALISA, hosted by Star 103.5 FM under the auspices of the EIB network. And we had Dr. Enin from the Kofi Annan International Peacekeeping Training Center. We also had Major General Retired Coleman, as well as the Deputy Minister for the Interior, Honorable James Agalga. And he spoke on terrorism and other issues facing Ghana. Take a look.
First of all, I'd want to touch on the issue of terrorism. Because in recent times, I know Ghanaians are sitting on tenterhooks, especially after the attacks in Ouagadougou, and of course, happenings in Nigeria, the atrocities unleashed by Boko Haram, and what is happening in Mali. These are all neighboring countries which have fallen victim to terrorism. And so the fears are that Ghana cannot be a country in isolation so far as terrorism in the sub-region is concerned. Those fears, I want to assure you, have been taken into account by our national security architecture and several measures put in place to ensure that our country is insulated from acts of terrorism and terrorist attacks. And so whilst we do not leave any stone unturned in our quest to ensure that we don't fall victim to terrorism, we'd also want to entreat all of us to desist from tendencies that would unnecessarily expose us to terrorist attacks. Security is, of course, it's of paramount importance to government, but it is the collective responsibility of all of us. I mean, we all have a duty, it is our civic responsibility to volunteer information when we become privy to such information which could be critical in mapping our strategies to contain terrorism. General talked about how problematic it is to manage the security architecture that we have adapted for ourselves as a country. And whilst I do not intend to run away from that fact, I wish to state that largely that architecture has been very successful, at least in ensuring that there is peace and security in this country. At the apex of that structure is the National Security Council, which is chaired by the President of the Republic. And I would say that ever since the current president assumed the position as chairman of that council, we have done extremely well to maintain the peace and security in our dear country. How have we chalked success in the management of security in this country? The government has invested a lot in the security sector, and so we can all see for ourselves the massive retooling of all the security agencies, starting from the police service, the fire service, the narcotics control board, which will soon become a commission, and even the Ghana Immigration Service. Let me start with the police service. And the police service, we all know, play a critical role in fighting terrorism and crimes of all kinds in our country. Over the period, the police service has seen massive retooling in ways that are unprecedented. And I can tell you, starting from 2012 till date, the vehicular strength of the police service has improved. And so we've been able to procure over 1,500 vehicles for the police, and that has made them more accessible. Highway patrols have now been intensified, and we can all bear testimony to this fact. In recent times, I can tell you some of the strategies we are not supposed to bring them to public attention, but this discussion, of course, compels me to volunteer a bit of information in that regard. I mean, police formations as well as military formations along the various borders of our country have stepped up their patrols, they have stepped up intelligence gathering to ensure that our borders are safe. In that regard, I should also say that government has laid before Parliament, and only today I was in Parliament to pilot the Immigration Service Bill, which fortunately for us was passed. And one of the highlights of the bill is the setting up of the Border Patrol Unit of the Immigration Service, which would be the first line of defense.
So that was the Honorable Deputy Minister for Interior, Honorable James Agaga, speaking about what the government has done to contain some of these threats, investments in retooling the security forces. And we are in this studio with Reverend Dr. Nia Mudaku. He's the chairman of the National Platform of Disaster Risk Reduction. We also have seated to his right the Honorable Kwame Governors Agboja, who is the MP for the Adaklu constituency, and he's also a member of the Defense and Interior Committee in Parliament. And we've been joined by my very good friend Jones Apple, Executive Director of the National Commission on Small Arms and Light Weapons. Jones, you're welcome to the conversation. Good to see you here. Before you came, we were talking about small arms, and we know where the people are manufacturing these arms, but why haven't we been able to get through to them, Alavanyo and other places?
Yes, I heard.
Do you care about those areas?
Yeah, we do care. I mean, if you are controlling an item, what you want to know, first of all, are the sources of the proliferation. And one of the identified sources, as the MP said, is the artisanal manufacturer. And they are in Alavanyo, Kumasi, Brownafu, Cape Coast, etc. I also heard the suggestion that he made, whether we couldn't find a way of helping them to finish their products well and absorb it. Them. I mean, it's a position that we share in the Small Arms Commission. We've suggested that to the Ghana Armed Forces to see whether they could get some of them even employed to assist them in repairing even the weapons that they have imported. Because when they bring the weapons, you know, some of them get damaged or whatever, and they have to be repaired. But the armed forces, really, what they told us is that, as for them, when it comes to enlistment and recruit, they don't compromise on their standards. If you are entering the Ghana Armed Forces and, I mean, at a graduate level, there's age limits, you know, and if you are non-graduate, that means about 18 years. If graduate, 21 or 23 years, they don't compromise on those things. And so that really was a limitation. So what we're thinking about really is that it's a bread and butter issue. What do we do? And so you heard of alternative livelihood that the minister spoke about yesterday when he was talking about the narcotics. Mm-hmm. Small Arms Commission is also, we've also been toying with the idea of alternative livelihood, because this these manufacturers or these artisans who produce the weapons, it's a bread and butter issue. I tell you what, in one of the surveys that we did, what they told us is that the amount of metal that they need to produce a rick is the same as what they need to produce a small arm, a small pistol that they can sell to an arm robber or anybody who needs it. And the rick costs 4 cedis. The small pistol that it produces is 50 cedis. So as a rational economic human being, what do you think that he will want to do? So it's an issue that we are grappling with. For me, if you ask my personal recommendation, looking at our level of enforcement of laws, I mean, I can talk about our environmental laws, not building on waterways, not dropping litter here. I can talk about pharmaceutical industry. Even these are legitimate business. I'm not too sure of our level of enforcement of our laws. If you ask me as an advisor to government for now as I sit here, I will tell you that we should proceed cautiously in trying to legalize the artisanal manufacture and attempt to regulate it. Why am I saying so? How sure am I that if somebody is in Pandai, if somebody is those areas where even during elections they can't go and is producing guns, how can I get officers there to go and monitor what they produce and who they sell them to? So it's a challenge that I believe is a dialogue that we have to continue, whether we want these blacksmiths who are dotted everywhere in this country, the guns that they produce, whether we want to legalize them. If Ghanaians think that is a way to go, then legalize them. And I mean, it's something, we are there, we are public servants, we do what Ghanaians want. And so for me, that's my take on the artisanal production. I think we should proceed cautiously. But against the background of how we enforce even legitimate things, building permits, environmental issues, pharmaceutical issues, issues that are really easy to enforce, traffic regulations, and you want to go into guns?
You talked about support from the security agencies. Specifically, what sort of efforts do you require from the security agencies to make you function?
To make what functional?
The Small Arms Commission function properly.
Oh, the Small Arms Commission, I know that we are a commission we've been set up by law. And we have our remit where we operate. We are supposed to help government to regulate and control small arms and light weapons and related matters.
Are you satisfied with?
Oh well, as a new institution, we have giants. I mean, we have Ghana Armed Forces. They've lived from colonial times. We've had a Ghana Police Service. We have records from 18 something on guns that are with the police service. So these are institutions that were already in the area of gun management of guns, I mean, for want of a better expression. And you have been created as a result of an international treaty that we have signed onto, the ECOWAS Convention and the United Nations Treaty on Small Arms, etc. And so it won't come overnight.
Right. It will take some time.
Take,
Reverend Doctor, let us critique the Honorable Deputy Minister's statements. He spoke about resourcing the police and other state institutions to work well. Got then X number of vehicles. But you're wondering, how does this tie in with our security issues? He's talking about a system that we have created which is exclusionary. So as in other countries where you could have the opposition having a conversation about national security, we have excluded other important actors from speaking about issues that are of not just partisan but national significance. What do you make of this?
Well, I think that it boils down to the lack of trust that has been built into the system over the period. You are not sure whether in dealing and talking about sensitive issues with people of other divergent views, whether or not you are safe. This is something that's not, you know, happening today. It's been there over the period from Kwame Nkrumah's time, even with the GAP, various stakeholders and parties who formulated and carved out the independence of Ghana. I mean, that kind of, you know, lack of trust that had been built into the system over the period is what I believe is resulting into this. But the retooling of the police for security purposes, I think is good. Except that we need to be make sure that even though we provided vehicles, they are used for the purposes for which they have been provided. Okay, we need to be sure about, you know, even in the traffic controlling, the visibility thing is good. But is it for vehicles to be parked alongside the roads for the whole period of the day and policemen standing by the traffic lights and making sure that people do not, or the vehicles are put on the road and going up and down and making sure that these various drivers of the commercial purposes for which they therefore arbitrarily, you know, break the laws are dealt with whilst commuting and not just being stationary, okay? So I think that all of it comes into play. Yes, and I
think that is of concern to you, and they do.
How often do you speak with the security brass that
I don't ever remember we calling them to explain anything they refused before, right from the Inspector General of Police.
How often?
Last year, I think three, four times, but there was issue specific. So it wasn't about briefing us generally. It was about, if it's about the police, it's about the scam in the recruitment and that. They spoke to us candidly. And to be honest, I found some of that information in the media, which was a breach of trust.
Your own people leaked the information
out. Yes,
of
course. And it is not funny.
Were they punished?
Well, I mean, you can't find anybody finger on the crime directly. But the truth is that I can imagine the next time you call them, they are going to be economical in what they tell you because the security services operate in a completely different way. That information management is on need-to-know basis. So if they think that you are part of the circle and you betray them, they're not going to be forthcoming. But what my brother said, you see, what I was saying is like...
Mr. Play.
Yes. Mm. You see, it's like the Kumasi shoe factory. We know that it costs us a lot of money to get accoutrement for the military. Boots and other things. So they take over Gihok in partnership with somebody. So they are producing something right now. What I'm saying is that in other countries that I visited, I realized that there are established organizations that produce arms. So it's not about giving license to somebody to go and produce a pistol at the back of his garage in Tamale. It's about, can we have a defense industry in this country, which is controlled? So age doesn't matter. It can be 50 years if you have the skills. We say we have two. We have one in Kumasi. We have one in Volta region that produces arms. So these people are rather moved to these places. So whatever they produce is controlled. That is what, it's not about giving license. So yeah, that's what I'm saying. And because you see, it costs us a lot of money. Handguns, the manufacture of handguns, our people have been doing for centuries. They may be expert in it. Military can make money out of it and generate IGF. We can control it. That is the way I see it. It's not about letting them do whatever they like because...
Mr. Play, you've been nodding.
You almost are going to say hallelujah.
That is an excellent and very fantastic presentation. I mean, for me, we've signed on to... Let me take the discussion. We've signed on to a treaty called the Arms Trade Treaty. Yeah. At the United Nations, was signed by our president himself. Now, it requires total disclosure of whatever you buy as a country. I was discussing it with some of our bosses, and they were like, but that's what it is.
We have signed.
We have. Oh no! It's a treaty. The United Nations now wants to monitor all weapons that are moving from any exporting country to any importing country. We've already started in West Africa, though, but they've taken it a notch higher, where there's a serious assessment. We call them in-country assessment and user assessment. It's very serious.
Are we complying? Are we complying?
So,
Jones?
And I mean. Don't. So just to support what you're saying, as a country for how long? For how long?
Are we complying?
I'm coming. For how long are we going to be buying everything from some manufacturer in some jurisdiction? And one thing is that when you buy, they disclose, because under their laws in their various countries, they are very strict that, look, if you sell 10 combat aircraft to Ghana, the company must tell their State Department or their control agency, and they'll tell the United Nations. And so everything, almost everything that we have is loan, because we didn't produce them. And so what he's saying is, for me, the way to go. You understand?
Yes.
That, look, why don't we find a way of building some small, some arms industry? It can be very small. Nigeria, for instance, they produce what they use. And so at least they have certain things that is very personal to them, that, you know, you want to. But for Ghana,
they produce arms in Nigeria?
Yes, they do. They have arms school, in Ghana. Okay. In Ghana, I think in West Africa, they are the only country that produces arms in West Africa. But Ghana, we have a good, very centrally located. We have everything that will go for us if we decide to have a small arms. It can be very nascent. Look, even this my small commission, we are constantly going to Liberia, Sierra Leone, to go and train them on how to mark their weapons, how to keep their records, etc. I'm always sending staff outside. You understand? So we have a potential that if Ghana decides to do what honorable is, and I've suggested that to, as in the past, Defense Minister, General Smith.
Okay.
Say, why don't we look at that? But since we are looking at yesterday's discussion, we are looking at fending off the threats.
Yeah, and what are your proposals?
Well, I raised the issue of small arms was discussed, but I think it was one of the issues. I mean, we are confronted with a number of challenges, including small arms. My take on the small, as I raised the issue yesterday, is that, look, over 800,000 to 900,000 weapons are produced every year by the exporting countries, and they have to sell these weapons. And so they are always finding ways and means of selling their weapons. You understand? Looking at Ghana, where we are now, and looking at the nature of our borders and all the things that you know, our capability, our capacity, I think that we have to be extremely careful. Guns and proliferation of guns is demand and supply. And so the supply is coming. But there must be a demand to meet the supply. And where we are now, my advice is that we have to find a way of curtailing the demand. How do we ensure? That's why I asked the question yesterday about the political parties. Look, Kumasi arrest. Tamale arrest of boys who had AK-47 with ISIS videos. The army of unemployed youth that we have, the numerous conflicts that we have around us should tell us that we have abundance of trained, I don't want to use the mercenaries, but we have abundance of trained people who know how to use weapons very well.
And definitely something
was. And so any slightest civil disorder in Ghana,
we should be alert.
They can take this, they can take advantage of it.
One,
to sell their services for money. Two, to propagate their religious and their own jihadist ideas. And so for me, what we need to concentrate on is how we can curtail the demand, so that even if the weapons come in,
there'll be no demand.
And we are solving, the courts are solving our land issues well. The chieftaincy issues are being addressed. Then we are very sure that people will not demand the weapons.
Okay. Gentlemen, let me pick your thoughts briefly on this one. Now, Honorable Agalga talked also about the increase in the number of policemen. And we're talking about how the retooling bit definitely is very important. There was also the bit about how that, yes, we have the increase in policemen, but if you go into details, not all of them are actually doing the real policing, you know, work. Is it just about the numbers, or you think we should be doing more? Let me start with you, Honorable Ajay.
Yeah, well, like the minister said, I mean, there are things you can't talk about, but believe me, there are so many new things that are happening in this country in terms of making our defense industry or defense establishment be fit for purpose. And indeed, retooling vehicles, surveillance equipment, and other things are just part of it. The retraining of the personnel to be able to do this is also ongoing. I want to believe that irrespective of what we do, I'll go back to the point that Doc made, and just recently made by my senior brother. You see, when people have things to do, when they believe tomorrow is going to be better, it's hardly easy for them to do things that will terminate their lives today. There's an army of young people in this country. Let's face it, it's not only about Ghana. It's a global issue that needed to be engaged in gainful employment. I think the more we can engage more of them to give them a hope of the future, the lesser the temptation for them to do anything that will endanger their own lives or this country.
Indeed. We'll leave you with the final word, Reverend Dr. Amudako.
Yeah.
Final word, your thoughts on way forward.
You know something, the situation is more dicier and complex than what we are just even discussing over here. You know, listening to what he said, I don't know whether you are privy to what the writer of The Confession of an Economic Hitman has said.
I've read that book.
You notice that if people are producing guns meant to be sold, and therefore there must be a demand for it.
Of course, a market.
Then obviously you are thinking of a situation where such people or their cronies will create an environment where the guns will be demanded for. There will be demand for the guns. Mm-hmm. So we should just not look at the situations as we find it here. Who are pulling the strings to make the guns become necessary to be demanded and then used?
Yeah.
For what purpose?
Okay.
Okay. So I just want our security systems, and I think Dr. Kwesi Enin said it right, concerning Boko Haram and things like that. Who tools them? Who are giving them the tools for it? For what they are doing there? And therefore, if that market is good, why shouldn't they then expand it to the sub-region?
Yeah.
Okay?
It's a business.
It's
a
business.
Have to expand.
Okay? So clearly, we need to look at all of these things in these various facets and then try and deal with them. That's how I would
end. Time has been threatening us, and so we would have to put a stop to this discussion. But it's been most illuminating and very engaging, and I thank you very much. Reverend Dr. Ni Amudako is the chairman of the National Platform of Disaster Risk Reduction. To his left is Jones Appler. He's the executive director of the National Commission on Small Arms and Light Weapons. And closest to me is the Honorable Kwame Govans Agboja, Member of Parliament for the Adaklu constituency and a member of the Defense and Interior Committee in Parliament. Gentlemen, we wish you the very best for the week and the weekend. And thank you for coming to GH today.
Thank you very much
for the opportunity.
All right.